Thank you very much for coming. I'm Tim Frye, a professor in the political science department at Columbia University, and I want to welcome you to today's event, What's Next? The Ukrainian Crisis in Global Context. Just by way of introduction, I want us to think back about 15 months and how just hard it was to imagine a large-scale conflict between Russia and Ukraine. 15 months ago, most Ukrainians had a positive or neutral view towards most Russians, and Russia was primarily focused on its internal problems, including its economic decline and trying to shore up legitimacy for a president whose popularity ratings had declined. Well, what a difference a year makes. If we think back, within the last year in Ukraine, we saw a government toppled after large-scale protests and a president forced to flee the country. We saw the shootdown of MH17, which led to the loss of 300 lives and which galvanized Europe to take a much harder line towards Russia. We saw a newly elected president and a newly elected parliament that has struggled mightily to introduce economic reforms and a growing impatience among friends of Ukraine abroad and the average citizens in Kiev and across the country to deliver some real tangible goods from the Maidan Revolution. We've also seen an economy that's almost in free fall, a decline in the hryvnia of 70% and projections for an economic decline of around 12% next year. Those were just announced today. So a pretty grim economic situation in Kiev. Within Russia, we've seen the rise of a great power nationalism that we have not seen in many years. We've seen anti-Western attitudes reach new peaks. We've also seen a real paradox in public opinion, where we have great support for the leaders of the breakaway republics of eastern Ukraine. At the same time, an awful lot of reluctance to send Russian troops on a large scale to fight in Ukraine. We've also seen a devaluation of the ruble of about 40% on the back of low energy prices. And most recently, we saw the murder of one of the most prominent opposition leaders a few hundred meters from the Kremlin walls under very suspicious circumstances. Within Europe, we've seen this somewhat wobbly coalition, to the surprise of many, more or less hold together to levy increasingly significant economic sanctions on Russia. We've also seen the rise of Angela Merkel as the main interlocutor between Europe and Russia. Within the US, we've seen sanctions levied in really innovative ways, targeted sanctions on individuals against the largest economy that sanctions have been used against on any real large scale, and on an economy that's largely integrated into the global economy, which again is also quite unusual for economic sanctions. We've also seen this increasingly fraught debate over whether or not to send defensive weapons to shore up the military in Ukraine. That's really split, I think, the White House and the Congress and a lot of foreign policy advisors. Well, we've got, I think, a really tremendous team to help us discuss these issues today. And I'll be moderating and throwing out questions for our experts. First, we have Professor Kimberly Marten of Barnard College. She is the Ann Whitney Olin Professor of Political Science, and her real area of expertise is in Russian foreign policy and international security. We have Professor of Political Science of Barnard College, Alex Cooley, who's an expert on Eurasia and issues of sovereignty across the globe. We have Jack Snyder, the Robert and Renee Belfer Professor of International Relations in Columbia University, an expert on nationalism, international relations, and security issues more generally. And Valery Kuchinsky, the former ambassador of Ukraine to the United Nations, who has a wealth of experience in diplomatic circles and tremendous knowledge of events in Ukraine. So we're really fortunate to have such a great team discussing what is arguably one of the most important issues going on in the world today. So I'd like to start off just by throwing out a question to our panelists about the recent ceasefire. We've seen the failure of one ceasefire agreement and a new ceasefire agreement signed under somewhat different conditions in Minsk in February that seems to be holding around the middle but fraying around the edges. And I'd like to just throw out to our group of experts, what are their predictions or about whether or not this ceasefire will hold and what it will mean actually for this ceasefire to hold. Who wants to start this up?
I can start. Thank you, Tim, for arranging this panel, and thank you all for coming today to talk about this really important topic. I'm just going to play devil's advocate and say that there's no way to predict whether or not the ceasefire is going to hold, and that whether it does or not depends completely on the decision that President Putin makes about whether or not he wants to continue supporting the rebels with military technology, military weapons, and Russian troops. And I think that the reason that it depends on him is that he really is the one who holds the cards here. Russia could just roll right over the top of Ukraine if it wished to, given its very superior military forces and the fact that it's such a much bigger state and a wealthier state than Ukraine is. But I think it's questionable what he will choose to do next, because he's somebody who enjoys surprises. And we could talk a lot about why that is the case. I think he's a tactical decision maker rather than a strategic decision maker. There is not a lot of discussion about policy choices happening in Russia, so the choices are made by a very small group of people that probably changes from time to time, that centers around President Putin. And so I think that he enjoys holding people in suspense, and it's actually part of his modus operandi from spending half his career in the KGB, that he likes playing games of deception and surprise, and so we'll all just have to wait to see what happens next.
Thank you. Well, first of all, I'd like to stress that the Minsk II agreement was a step in the right direction. For Ukrainian side, and even for the separatists, the need to have a sort of intermission was extremely important, specifically for Ukraine, because the losses were tremendous. Nobody can be sure what will come next. But even at this stage, we know that one of the provisions of the Minsk II and the Minsk I accords was the movement withdrawing of the heavy weapons. So apparently it started, and both sides claim that they already did it. But the SMM, the observers from OSCE, did not have a chance to see where these weapons go, specifically on the part of the separatists. Ukrainian side mostly, well, there were also some cases, but it's open, it's transparent. So the big question is where this weaponry, very sophisticated weapons, go now. And this is one of the first requests and demands of the OSCE, to know that it has been withdrawn away from the military, from the front. My personal view, I am very, cautiously pessimistic. It seems that there are reports now that the weaponry is being moved closer to Mariupol, which looks like the next target of Russian forces and the separatists. So we don't have much to wait. I think as spring comes in, we'll see the following chapter of this tragedy. Thank you.
So I'll also rephrase and repackage the question to my liking, which is I think rather than, you know, will the ceasefire hold or not, we have to ask ourselves, what realistically is the Ukrainian state going to look like after a ceasefire and this prolonged period? And, you know, I think we conflate the idea of the ceasefire holding to the idea that we can go back to the status quo ante. I think that's very doubtful right now. One of the fundamental insights, I think, of international relations and state formation theory is that war makes states and states make war. Now, that doesn't mean that we're going to see the absorption of eastern Ukraine. It's not Crimea, and today we have the front page stories from the Russian president about he had thought all of this up before the green men appeared in Crimea. But I do think it takes off the table two possible organizational forms, right? I think the idea of going back to an independent Ukraine from the post-Cold War period through 2014, the way it was once configured just seems practically very doubtful. And I don't think we'll have an annexation, so what's left? I think the possibilities are the best case scenario is the peace holds, we move, the predictions about what will happen over the summer don't come true, and we move to a negotiated settlement that includes some sort of, radical decentralization type of agreement for the Donbass, possibly the sharing of a couple of economic and legal spaces. We get into some sort of hybrid arrangement. I think that's the best case scenario. I think the more likely scenario is that we move into a frozen conflict type of scenario, right, where Ukraine is nominally sovereign, juridically sovereign, but doesn't exercise control over these eastern provinces. And I think, the more that we have the separation of these spaces, normative, legal, economic, the more that it will add to the sense that Ukraine has been divided. So I'm sorry I can't be more optimistic, but I think the conflict itself, although it could be much worse, has inalterably changed some facts on the ground.
So in Kim's spirit of exploring what a devil's advocate might argue, I'll argue the opposite devil to Kim, reversing the two assumptions. What if we assume that Putin is strategic? And what if we assume that it's actually Ukrainian agency and developments that will determine whether the ceasefire holds? Where would that analysis go? And so from that standpoint, Putin might have three motives to try to destabilize the ceasefire. One of them that people have talked about is a possible concern about the Russian lines of communication to Crimea. And so if the Ukrainians get in the way of that, that would be a reason why Putin might want to push back, even at the cost of the ceasefire. A second reason why Putin might be happy to overturn the ceasefire would be if he saw the consolidation of democratic, political, and economic reform in the parts of Ukraine that he does not control, and might see the need to renew the turmoil in Ukraine to derail the consolidation of those positive developments. And the third possibility is that Putin might want to create pressure on Ukraine and on the West, threatening the ceasefire, just to extort money. Now, I think this is unlikely because Putin's apparently preferred strategy for extorting money is to threaten to turn off the gas to Ukraine or to charge exorbitant rates. But that's a third possible motive.
So this reminds me of Colin Powell's statement before the U.S. led forces went into Iraq, where he said, if you break it, you bought it. So if you invade, you have to be around to help set up the institutions. And I think President Putin's attitudes towards eastern Ukraine, as reflected in the Minsk agreements, is I broke it, you bought it. In that these territories are supposed to remain part of Ukraine through some constitutional negotiations to try to assign the various forms of sovereignty and authority to these entities. Anybody have a sense of kind of what this might look like? Alex used the term frozen conflict, but that seems to cover an awful lot of territory. Do we have a sense of what the real issues are and what are kind of hopeful signs that we might see, or more depressing signs we might see going forward about whether or not this key issue in the Minsk II agreements will bear fruit?
I think the main idea of Vladimir Putin is to destabilize Ukraine as much as possible and to not to allow Ukraine to join the family of European nations, to join well, to be part of Europe. And for that, definitely he's going to have his military actions till the victorious end, which is the tradition in Russian army. So I want to repeat that I'm very pessimistic. I think that after a short intermission and after all sorts of discussions, maybe even after in July, when some of the European countries will think of lifting some of the sanctions, then there'll be another surprise, then there'll be another attack. But it looks like the specific goal is to have that land bridge to Crimea, because we don't have to forget that you still Russia has a big load on its shoulders. What to do with Crimea? There are a lot of problems. And how to reach Crimea? So I think this is the goal, and we have to expect that this route will be fought for after Mariupol and then going down to the south of Ukraine. Thank you.
Can I just jump in on another part of what Tim was talking about in terms of institution building? I think that the challenges in that regard are immense, and I think they're immense from the Russian side, because what we've seen is that Russia is not really a country that is run by institutions. It's a country that's run by individuals. And so to expect that Russia is going to create new institutions in eastern Ukraine that will have governance responsibilities, I think doesn't fit what we know about recent Russian history. But at the same time, I think it's difficult to expect that Ukraine is going to make much progress in institution building. There's certainly people in Ukraine who are passionately trying to create new institutions. But the problem is that the country is facing pretty close to an economic collapse. And the level of corruption has not apparently declined any since it has been in the past couple of years, despite people's best intentions. And the idea that now, facing all of the costs that have been involved in the military activities, facing the constant need to keep up its level of military preparedness, facing the need to have many of the people who are actually the leaders of the workforce potentially be drafted into the Ukrainian armed forces for future protection purposes, I think it's very unlikely that Ukraine is going to have the ability to build institutions. And many people have been concerned about what this means, particularly in the area of security, because of the growth of warlordism that has occurred both on the Russian-supported side and on the Ukrainian-supported side, including evidence that warlordism is emerging in Western Ukraine, not merely along the lines of the battlefront. And so I think that maybe a grounds for pessimism is not just that the conflict will continue, but that it's just not clear what kind of stable institutions can emerge out of the current situation.
Yeah, just to add to those important points, I think there's an incentive here to actually keep the very status of Ukraine and the state of its institutions in abeyance, if you're the Kremlin, right? To sort of wield the threat of escalation, of more instability, as, you know, a potential, you know, potential weapon going forward. And so, you know, the one kind of dilemma I see for Moscow in all this is, you know, the frozen conflict type of, you know, lack of institutional space. I agree with that would be just fine, except you still want to have influence over Kiev's foreign policy orientation. And so that's why, you know, that might be one driver to reach a settlement that either provides an institutional settlement in that leaders of eastern Ukraine would have veto power over major foreign policy decisions. That could be one mechanism, or some sort of grand bargain in which Ukraine would be dubbed neutral, right? I mean, it could go either at the sort of institutional level or the international level. But I think absent guarantees about the actual political orientation of Ukraine itself, you know, I don't think we're going to see some sort of stable, lasting settlement, or the carving out of institutions that don't accomplish those goals.
Also care about the regime type. He wants it not to be a fully functioning liberal democracy. He wants it to be a country that is not successful in Western-oriented economic reforms. So I think that rather than having a deal that settles on a division of Ukraine between a Russian-oriented rump part in the east and a dynamically reforming part in the west, if such a thing could be imaginable, that Putin wants not a frozen conflict with clear demarcations, but a slushy, unfrozen conflict that will keep everything in doubt, as you suggested. But this presents a potential problem for Putin. Think of the bizarre negotiating position that the Russians had on requiring the Ukrainians to pay for the gas that was going to the Russian-held parts of Ukraine, where not only are they not building coherent economic and political and legal institutions there, but they're not even pretending to. They're saying it's somehow still Ukraine's responsibility to do that, and that's not a frozen concept. That's a really slushy and strange one. And so, you know, can Putin get away with this just in terms of his legitimating rhetoric? How can he explain, even to people on, you know, his side of this dispute, why he's not owning up to a responsibility for governance and economic development in eastern Ukraine?
You heard it here for slushy conflict. I've never been before, but I like it. So, a couple of you obliquely referenced this, but about possible constraints on Putin. Jack mentioned that Ukrainian agency was important. The ambassador mentioned building the land bridge to Crimea, but this is no easy task. This is a long, exposed line that would be vulnerable, likely to counterattacks by the Ukrainians. It would be hard to imagine how the rebel forces would be able to project power across this long territory. So this would be pretty, I think, costly for President Putin in terms of the stakes that he would have to bring to the table in order to achieve this land bridge to Crimea, which you could see as one kind of equilibrium outcome that might allow President Putin to be satisfied by being able to fund Crimea, but also be able to put pressure on Ukraine. But we also have public opinion in Russia, which it's an autocratic regime, but the Kremlin certainly pays an awful lot of attention to presidential approval ratings. So we have military costs, we have debates among Russian elites about whether or not this is the right thing to do. So can we talk a little bit about what are possible constraints on President Putin, given that I think the image in the West is often as Putin as this grand puppet master who's been manipulating events. And I think an equally plausible case is that President Putin is scrambling to make up grounds, having backed the wrong candidate in the showdown on the Maidan, and has been just making this up as he goes along, seeing what he could get away with in Crimea and in eastern Ukraine, rather than having some kind of master strategy. And I don't know whether that should make us feel better or worse. On the one hand, if he's improvising, that raises the possibility that escalations and that neither side wants could be put into play, rather than thinking of Putin as this grand chess master. So I've thrown a bunch of ideas out there, but I want us to kind of question a little bit this narrative that everything depends on Putin, he's unconstrained, and he can do whatever he wants. So
everyone's jumping at the bit.
Yeah.
So that's good.
I think this just further supports the idea that Putin is not a strategic thinker. He's a tactical thinker. He thought to himself, you know, Krim Nash, the getting Crimea back for the people would raise his popularity without considering the fact that Crimea is a peninsula that's very hard to get access to. You're absolutely right about having a difficult time even continuing a land bridge. The latest indications are that rather than thinking of it as someplace that's going to have a lot of economic development, Putin might be thinking of it as a military outpost. He could put weapons there that would then have more reach over the Black Sea. But, you know, I would just point out that when the Crimean takeover first happened, there was all kinds of angst in the West that this was going to be Russia using this for new energy developments without thinking about the fact that if you have sanctions in place, Russia can't get access to the Western financing and Western technology that it needs to do new energy developments. And so I think all of this indicates that it really was not strategically well thought out as part of a master plan. It was opportunistic. And I think the biggest danger is that the kinds of thinking that have had the most weight among the Russian public are things that talk about this being similar to World War II, in the sense that you have fascists on the one side and the great Russian patriots on the other, and the beginnings of a real stress on ethnic nationalism, on saying that we are doing this to save the Russian ethnic groups, the Russian-speaking populations who are being threatened by the fascists. And if that ends up being what is the most useful for Putin going forward, I think that the end result could become much worse than it is now and quite dangerous for global security more broadly.
Okay. Thank you. Well, if we speak about the constraints that could be further put on Putin, I think that the sanctions have proved that they have an impact, that they have had an impact on Russia. They are very, painful, and the results, $150 billion were taken from the country. And so I think if the sanctions continue, this is my personal view, that might put, that may be additional constraints on Putin to continue his aggression. Then the other sensitive issue, which has been discussed lately quite widely, is the providing Ukraine with defensive weaponry from the Western countries, specifically from the United States. The view here in the States, specifically in the Congress, everybody knows that there are a lot of politicians, statesmen, political analysts who are in favor of this move. Of course, there is danger, and I'm sure we can discuss that. But in my personal view is that if Ukrainian army can, endure, can show more strength on the battlefield, then it might bring some, doubts in Mr. Putin's mind whether to continue having these thousands killed Russian nationals being sent back to Russia from the war front. And I am absolutely sure that these may stop him. And because, so far we have seen that all these promises, all these slogans, they didn't work. If it were not for the sanctions, Russians would have already reached Crimea, would have taken Odessa and maybe Kharkiv and Dnipropetrovsk. The sanctions have been very painful and, very sensitive. And the situation in the front, there was no Ukrainian army. The army, in fact, was created during this year. And the army is showing its ability to fight back with all the old ancient equipment that they're using. Sometimes these volunteers have been buying military armaments for their own money to fight back. And the last point, maybe we'll continue on that, I think that Mr. Putin did something that through the history of Ukraine nobody managed to do. He united Ukrainian people around the idea of Ukrainian independence. The level of patriotism in the country, including, this is not an ethnic issue. Ukrainians, Russians, whoever live in Ukraine, they're fighting. The language spoken in the anti-terrorist operation is Russian. The people, they are ethnically Russian, but they're fighting for their country. And this is main, and this is the main. So I'm not that pessimistic about the possibilities of Ukraine to rebuff, to endure, and to really, maybe in not tomorrow, but in the nearest future, to become a normal democratic European state. Thank you.
So I think implicit in Tim's formulation is this idea that constraints, again, take you back to how things were before. And I absolutely agree that there are constraints that are operating at a different level, but there's also rhetorical entrapment, I think, that's operating. And so, there's I think it's very difficult to sort of, keep tracking how this is playing out at domestic level, at a regional level, at a global level. But, we should try. And, my sense is that there have been a number of regional moves undertaken by Russia. Again, I think tactically, absolutely right. I don't think it's part of a grand plan, but it's been a way of also escalating politically what's at stake in other parts of the former Soviet Union, right? So these integration agreements that Russia signed with the Georgian breakaway territories, both Abkhazia and South Ossetia, clearly penned by Surkov, clearly this kind of mimetic, as opposed to sort of, the Georgian association agreement with the EU, they were going to do integration agreements, with Russia. So that's part of it. Rogozin's comments on Transnistria. I think there's a sense that, Russia's sort of toward, on the one hand, it invokes international law to justify a lot of its actions, right? So Russian MFA talks a lot about, principles of self-determination and responsibility to protect and international humanitarian imperatives and this kind of stuff. On the other hand, it has this revisionist impulse to try and overturn Western rule sets, right? Like, we want to talk about rules because those rules that we agreed to after the Cold War, they don't apply here. So the question is, what rules do, right? What does a Russian-led order look like? And it might be that the Russian alternative in these sorts of spaces is exactly this kind of patchwork, clientelist, tactical kind of set of just improvising that's not subject to sort of, concrete norms and, treaties and memoranda and this kind of thing. Maybe that in itself is the Russian-led paradigm. So I think, unfortunately, it's not just contained to a Ukraine kind of interaction. It has effects in Georgia, in Moldova, obviously in the Baltic states and other places.
So Putin definitely does have weaknesses, but the Ukrainians and the West don't necessarily need to push hard on those weaknesses. So if Putin is in economic difficulties right now, it's mostly because of the fracking revolution in oil production and its effect on the world oil price. In comparison to that, the impact of economic sanctions on the Russian economy is small. I think the impact of the sanctions is mostly important for its symbolic effects. And it's mostly important for Western politics and Western unity rather than, us needing to ratchet up the sanctions to deter Putin even better. Another weak point that people have mentioned is the possible vulnerability of the supply routes to Crimea, which is an idea that could tempt people down a line of thought that said, oh, well, let's give the Ukrainians some extra heavy weapons to be able to nip at the flanks of those supply routes even more effectively. I think the impact of that kind of a strategy would be counterproductive in two ways. One is that it would give Putin an opportunity to push back and enjoy the impact of the resulting violence on the further destabilization of the rest of Ukraine, its political institutions and its economic reforms would be hurt by this. And at the same time, the other benefit to Putin is that it would solve any problems that he might have over the narrative of Russian policy in eastern Ukraine, because it would allow him to wrap himself in the rhetoric of nationalist self-defense against the aggressive fascist regimes that oppose him, and all that rhetoric that we've already heard.
Yeah, I think it's probably one thing for the Russian public to see Russian soldiers come back after fighting in a Ukrainian civil war, and it might be a very different narrative if the narrative revolves around U.S. weapons being used to kill Russian boys. That might be a cause for the current reticence about sending Russian troops into Ukraine to really flip pretty quickly. I wanted to take the discussion in a little different direction by saying, what if this isn't really about Ukraine? What if it's really about Europe? What if this idea is, I found the cleavage that can undermine the whole post-Cold War, post-communist apple cart and drive a wedge between the U.S. and Europe and between those countries in Europe who are culturally sympathetic to Russia, economically dependent on Russia, and those who are not? So I want to throw that out there as a possible motivation, given that, you know, Putin has historically not felt great emotional attachment to eastern Ukraine prior to the Maidan Revolution, but he has always been keen on Russia's relations with Europe, where economics are really important, and the role of Russia as a great power, as a European great power, has been in play. So what if this is really not so much about Ukraine, but about Europe? People agree, disagree? Alex, you want to take this up? I see you nodding.
Yeah, sure. I think here we get to some fundamental differences in how the two sides are viewing the origins and what's at stake of the conflict and what's at stake, right? So I think the Ukrainian side and most of the West views this as a clear violation of Ukrainian sovereignty, right? A clear breaking of established international rules and law, an overturning of the post-Cold War order, violations of treaty commitments like the Black Sea Fleet Agreement, the Budapest Memorandum, and so forth. I think in Russia, this is nested in a much greater discussion now about the dimensions of the post-Cold War settlement. Right, so for the Russians to say that this isn't just about Ukraine, this is about you pushing us too far in a long series of steps, whether it's NATO expansion, whether it's the EU wanting sort of an exclusive economic relationship with its former states, with this whole system of sort of rules that the West supposedly makes and that we've had to take, that we're not going to take it anymore, and that we're going to put our foot down, and we need to have a discussion about rules and who makes them and who gets to be at the table. And, that's a widely felt kind of view, certainly amongst, certain academics and analysts. I mean, the traditional value stuff I don't think sticks as much, but I think the question of who has the authority to make rules and whose rules we play under is certainly a part of this. And I think, ultimately what's interesting to me when Putin makes the Kosovo analogy here, right, It's not so much the legal analogy to Kosovo. I mean, that's because I think the whole point why Russia was so adamant against Kosovo independence, you see, is in the briefs that they filed, right? This would constitute a dangerous precedent, right? That self-determination is only to be exercised in extreme circumstances. Actually, in a Russian brief saying when there's an armed conflict, an armed threat against the people, that's the only time in which this option can be exercised. So I think it's less about the legal issue of Kosovo, and it's more about the right. Who gets to make exceptions, right? That's what really irked the Russians about Kosovo. That, you know, we got to say Kosovo happened, it's sui generis because we said so, right? And don't worry about it. And so I think the Russians want a similar kind of great power status, the ability to make up rules as they go along because they said so, and have that be almost sort of acknowledgement of their status. But it's conceptually, it's a mess. And I'm not going to sort of try and, you know, gather sort of coherence out of it. But we're just looking at two fundamental levels of analysis.
I think Alex is absolutely right that status is the key issue that's involved. But I've been doing some research on the early 1990s for my current project. And I just want to remind us all of a couple of things. The first thing is that anti-Western nationalism, that included ethnic nationalism, was already rearing its head in Russia by 1990. When there were debates in the parliament in Soviet times about the direction that Gorbachev was taking the country. And so this isn't new, and this wouldn't really at that time didn't have anything to do with Western actions. It was coming out of a domestic debate in the Soviet Union about the direction the country was going and a really strong degree of unhappiness about the fact that Gorbachev was making unilateral concessions to NATO and the United States in arms control treaties, including the Intermediate Nuclear Forces Treaty, including the Conventional Forces in Europe Treaty, that marked the decline of Soviet power in Europe. So that's the first thing to keep in mind. It really started as being a domestic set of circumstances, and this plays very well into a continuing set of domestic circumstances that have been there now for, what is it, 25 years, if I'm counting correctly. The second thing is that what really got people irked in the early 1990s was not the idea that NATO expansion created some kind of a territorial threat to Russia, because NATO expansion did not really hit the headlines as a possibility that was being considered by the United States and by the NATO countries until 1995. Well, what had happened already by that point was airstrikes in Bosnia that were carried out by NATO under U.S. leadership, but most importantly, under UN authorization. It wasn't something that the United States was doing independently or that NATO was doing independently. These were airstrikes that were being carried out because the Russian Foreign Minister Kozarov and the Russian President Yeltsin signed off on allowing the United Nations to do that. And it got the nationalists completely up in arms that these airstrikes were being carried out by the United States on a traditional Russian ally, namely Serbian forces that went back in history as being having this ethnic connection and this religious connection to Russia. So when we're thinking about neutrality, when we're thinking about the role of the West and everything, I think it's just very important that we stay tied to those origins of where this came from and realize that it feeds into them rather than being something that has just happened recently.
If Putin were thinking of the current crisis as an opportunity for a showdown with the West over dominance in Europe, he would be making a really big miscalculation. Europeans have been his best customers, and increasingly they're customers that have alternatives. Lithuania and a bunch of other East European countries are busily opening up new liquefied natural gas facilities so that they have some source of gas other than Russia. And Putin's aware of this. He's also aware that he can sell his hydrocarbons to, say, China, but we've just been through that bargaining exercise, and he found that if China's your only bargaining power partner, you wind up selling your goods real cheap. So that can't be very attractive to him. So I'm assuming, just from deducing the obvious logic of the situation, that Putin realizes that now is not the time for a power play vis-a-vis Europe.
Ukraine?
Well, let me add another side to the story. There is a school of thought, and I'm in favor of this, that Putin, in fact, expects to be treated as equal by the European leaders, not only by Merkel and Holland, by world leaders, specifically by Barack Obama. And he thought that this is not the case. So that was his reaction. Well, including the Olympic Games and many other examples from the past. But his main idea, I think, remains that it's the great powers who are to decide the future of the world, not these small nations, those that they have no right to speak. It's the big powers. This is the same mentality that existed and the same system that existed after Yalta. But Yalta was dead after the fall of the Berlin Wall and after the demise of the Soviet Union. So, obviously, Russia and Putin specifically was not very happy. And this idea that it was West, the United States, who did their utmost to subdue Russia, this is absolutely wrong, because if we look at the 90s, it was the United States and the European countries who really helped Russia to get up. And in 1992, Russia was the third recipient of American financial aid after Israel and Egypt. And then the West helped Russia to become a normal, tried to become a normal capitalist country. I mean, it failed. They failed. But they did a lot to help Russia. And now they are being accused of, some subjugation and something like that. And he also is absolutely sure that it's the U.S. who was behind the Euromaidan in Kiev. He is absolutely sure, and he made this idea taken and by population in Russia and by, quite a lot of people abroad. And speaking about his attempts to put a wedge between U.S. and Europe, yes, we are facing it right now. We're witnessing it. Hungary, Czech Republic, and Spain, and these efforts would continue. And to rebuff it, to sort of try to win this war, these attempts, to counter these attempts, I think the Western European countries and the United States should be very close together in this moment of truth. Thank you.
I have two questions, and then we'll open up the floor to the audience for your questions. You've all been very patient. So, the first question I have is, we've talked a lot about international relations, but what goes on within Ukraine still depends a lot on the choices that the Ukrainians make. And I think there's been a growing impatience, I think, among Ukrainians and among supporters of the pro-Western government and the president in Ukraine to really take seriously economic reforms that Ukraine, by everyone's admission, badly needs. The IMF has been very frustrated, I think, in trying to put together a reform package. The first reform package that was voted on in late December included a number of agreements that were not made public. Deputies weren't clear what they were voting on. The harshest austerity measures were watered down, and now they're taking a second bite at the apple under, an awful lot of IMF pressure. There have been calls on the president to fulfill his pledge to sell some of his economic assets that he promised to do before taking office. So I think there's an awful lot of impatience building about why isn't the Ukrainian government doing more to conduct economic reform, given that the wolf is at the door, and that the fate of the country is at stake. Ambassador Kuchinsky, do you want to, as our meeting in Ukraine next, do you want to talk a little bit about this sense of impatience and whether you think it's well-founded, or is this just the normal democratic process and democracy is ugly and it takes time to make decisions? And
No, I don't think so. Well, I think to answer this question, we have to face the reality. The country is at war. 20% of its territory in the east has been taken by Russia, by separatists, Russian separatists, put it this way. Then Ukraine has to pay on a daily basis for gas that it is receiving from Russia. And with the war going on, it's not easy really to continue and to try to fulfill the reform plan. But it seems that something is going on. Well, first of all, you know that there was a Ukrainian parliament adopted 10 or 11 bills in order to get this assistance from IMF. In other words, raising taxes, raising pension aids, and so on. That is something, well, you can call it reform, but or you cannot, but I think this is to show that something is going on. Yesterday, the president signed, well, a few days ago, signed the decree on this committee against corruption. The number of people who there have been already endorsed, and now it's the director of this body is being chosen. It has already been chosen, and it's a matter of a few days when this body will start working, because corruption is rampant. It continues to be, and not much has changed, really. So we'll see. Lustration, in fact, that was introduced did not work properly, let's face it. And there were other, a lot of lofty ideas. Incidentally, if we want to be frank, there is a sort of, if not a wedge, but there are differences, and which are obvious, between the president camp and the prime minister camp, because, you know, two different approaches can be really seen. What is important that both parties managed to agree on this list of, you know, bills in order to get the assistance from IMF. You know, I think what is also extremely important, which sometimes is forgotten, is that, you know, the people in the country, even those who are maybe not so don't like maybe some of the leaders, there is a unity. You know, after these, drastic and very painful laws have been adopted, in spite of our, you know, friends' interference in whip-up tension and protests in the country, there was an understanding that this is a necessity to country to endure and to really persevere in this terrible situation. So, as far as internal situation in the country is concerned, I mean, this is a common view that if there is no, or at least that the interference from outside, from our northern neighbor, is somehow controlled, the country and the Ukrainian people will succeed. Thank you.
Thanks. I want to have one last question before we open it up. And this is, to put this context in a more historical or international perspective, we've heard that this is a new form of hybrid war, the introduction of the little green men into Crimea, and the use of soldiers without military uniforms or clear insignia. We hear that there's a new information war, that this new technology that these spin doctors in Russia have come up with to, you know, try to use propaganda to achieve political ends. Is this anything new in international relations, or is this just old great power politics, the strong do what they can, the weak suffer what they must, and that's the way the world works in a state of anarchy, and, you know, we shouldn't be surprised by any of this. We've got three renowned experts on the global affairs. Anybody want to take a crack at it?
Well, we used to talk a lot about the history of great power struggles over buffer zones. It's one of those old chestnuts of diplomatic history and international relations scholarship. And it looks like we're, once again in an era in this part of the world and elsewhere where great powers are pushing against each other in buffer zones. And so is this back to the future, some pattern from the past? Some research on the death of states shows that over the last 200 years, most of the states that have died were exactly buffer zones between two great powers. So that's a grim prognostication. But it's not clear that struggle over buffer zones is always the same. Sometimes the struggle happens because there are resources or strategic positions in the buffer zone that are very valuable to one and therefore both of the contending parties. So in the past, the Romanian oil in the Caucasus, oil in Indonesia before World War II, or the Turkish Straits before a whole string of wars. People fought over these things because they really mattered to the war-making capacity and the economic dynamism of one or both of the great powers. But sometimes people fight over buffer zones just because they're there. And some of the best books about the economics of contestation over buffer zones point out that it's the outside powers sometimes far from stripping valuable assets out of these lands that lie between them are doing the opposite. They're subsidizing the borderlands countries in order to lure them into clientelistic relations. So I think in Ukraine, the pattern that we're looking at is more the latter type of buffer zone conflict. Both sides are sort of paying a lot of money for the privilege of winning friends and playing in the game in a buffer zone where the pragmatic value to either side of the buffer zone that's at stake is less than they're anteing up. And I think that should be a word of caution to the great powers that are playing in this buffer area.
So I'll kind of come at it from the opposite tact, and I think as much as these enduring concepts are important, the thing I see as new are some of just the sort of intensification of the network effects that the sort of media, hybrid warfare, whatever you want to call it, has had. So it's not that we haven't had sort of soft power before and these kinds of ambiguous actions and so forth. It's, I think, in the current sort of media environment, and I see this sort of studying the Central Asian states' reaction to this. I think all the governments, without exceptions, are absolutely terrified at the psychological pressure generated by the Russian media campaign. And it's put them in a real dilemma. So if you are, say, your typical Central Asian authoritarian strong ruler, what do you fear most coming into the Ukraine crisis? Do you fear a Maidan-like street protests that's supposedly funded by the West and NGOs and prompted? Or do you fear this sort of intense Russian kind of wave of psychological pressure, media stories, and so forth, or even sort of green men showing up in a place like Dushanbe, where you have 5,000 Russian troops, right? Or, you know, the various sort of facilities in Kazakhstan and so forth. So, so it's really difficult. And I think it's not that the actions are new; it's just their instantaneous impact. I think that's really at stake here. That they're for all to see. And what it does structurally, and Dan Exon and I have written a little bit on this, is it makes it very difficult to compartmentalize your interactions, right? And I think, you know, in some ways the West is facing this now, that it wants to have a different policy towards Ukraine versus other NATO allies, like the Baltic states, right, or Poland, which have sort of Article 5 commitments and so forth, and keeping the messages, right, properly segmented, I think becomes more and more difficult in a kind of intense media environment like this. So I don't know if it's new or old, but I think sort of those aspects of globalization and information flows that structurally complicates things.
Can I just add one thing on the information flows? I think, you know, 10 years ago, the thought was that the internet was going to open up everything and the West would have a real advantage because of all the different messages that would come across. And I think what we're seeing instead is that authoritarian states play the media game so much better than an open society does. And it makes it very hard for the West to have a chance of winning what the new hybrid information war is, because the United States is not trying to get across, or NATO is not trying to get across, or the West is not trying to get across one single message, or even to give disturbing messages to people that make them doubt everything. Instead, openness is not something that you can control. So,
let's open up the floor for questions. If you could just say who you are and what your question is, and keep your questions succinct, and keep them in the form of a question. If you will. Do we have a microphone here?
Yeah.
Great. Do you want to come up to the front? Very briefly.
Oh, Orlin Jurinkas. I'm a refugee from the old Russian Institute. I think the Ukrainian-Russian antagonism goes back a long way. I suspect many Russians still refer to Kokhlandia, but we won't go into that. Secondly, whether you have Putin in charge or not, Russia has been invaded from the north, the south, the east, and the west, and anybody running the country, whether Tsar or Stalin or Putin, would want what we euphemistically call a sphere of influence. Thirdly...
Good, good, good. Thank you very much. We have to keep this to one or two points, please. One point...
I didn't ask the question.
Well, so what is it? I mean, is this about Putin? Let me rephrase your question. Is this about Putin, or is this about any Russian leader? Would policy be any different if President Putin said, I've had a good run, I'm going to Miami?
I could join Kozarov.
So,
well, definitely there is a truth to it that, you know, the situation makes leader act in a specific manner. Even if we look at Putin, remember 2000, 2001, 2002, his promises, his attitude toward the West, to 9/11, and whatever, and his prospects of joining NATO, by the way, and so on. And then slowly it started to change. So I think it's a two-way process. On the one hand, he felt that this is something that his country needs. On the other hand, he thought that that would be something, if he does that, if he continues his, let's say, anti-Western moves, that would be, let's say, supported by the majority of the country, by the majority of the people in the country. But he also, through this process, through this evolution, he added some of his personal touches to these events, from his former professional experience, from his psychic, and something else. So I think had it been another leader, maybe we would have had a more plausible situation. But as Ukrainian president used to say, it's in Ukrainian sounds, maimo shumaimo, we have what we have.
Here in the front, in the red shirt.
We've talked a bit about Ukraine's economy, but we haven't talked about oligarchs or business groups in Ukraine. I'd be interested to know to what extent those structures have changed and to what extent they ought to be changed or can be changed.
And I would just ask our moderator to jump in too, given his extensive political economy expertise.
The oligarchs are still very powerful in Russia. Governor Kolomoisky has combined economic and political power in a way that I think many people find troubling. One of the most difficult parts of the job for many of the Ukrainians from the diaspora community who've gone back to take jobs in the administration of the president, within the parliament, who are this kind of fabulous 1500, they call them, who are supposed to be the leading edge of reformers. You know, they've already, a number of them have written this open letter to President Poroshenko saying, we don't have to be here. We're giving up an awful lot to come back and serve our country, and we can leave. And we, if we don't see more progress towards trimming the power of the oligarchs to establishing a real deep and thorough the reform of civil service, of state procurement, of cleaning up the banking sector, then we're going to leave. And I think that this should be a threat that if I was the president, I would take really very seriously. One thing we know from the political economy of reform is that it's very important to move quickly after elections. And this is one thing that people find very troubling. We had presidential elections in May. We had parliamentary elections in the fall. We're already into March, and we're only, you know, beginning to see reforms passed, primarily with the gun of the IMF at the head of the Ukrainian government. And what we saw in Eastern Europe is that the IMF was often trailing behind the reformist governments in terms of the extent of reforms that the actual reformers wanted to see. President Poroshenko, I think, is in an extremely difficult position, as is Prime Minister Yatsenyuk. They're also creations of the old regime. And there is a certain, I think, legacy of the relationships and the power base they have that make their job doubly difficult. Next question. Who wants to help us out? Gail, do you want to? Thanks.
So I was struck by the fact that none of the devil's advocates took an optimistic approach to anything. And I was wondering whether, if we were sitting here a year from now, whether there's just any ray of hope that anybody sees that will look back and think, oh my gosh, you know, it was so obvious, it was staring us in the face, but we didn't see it.
Yeah, just to follow up on this, you know, 15 months ago, if we were sitting in this room, who would have predicted the tenor of the conversation that we're having today? So before we achieve some kind of cognitive closure, let's explore some alternative scenarios from our preternaturally pessimistic group of international relations scholars. I know this won't come easier naturally, but can someone spill out a kind of more positive path forward for the region?
Okay. It's not going to make Gail happy, though. So one of my hobbies over the last couple of months has been to read some economic history and economic theory about the problem of an economic order that is only partially marketized, that retains many features of clientelistic, patronage-based politics, which we might call corruption, yet also has sectors or enclaves or partially developed institutions of market-based legality in economic transactions. And, you know, the answer is that most countries that developed economically developed out of exactly that kind of hybrid, irrational, impossible situation where, you know, we're taught that either you have to have a centrally planned economy or a patronage-based economic system, or else you have to have shock therapy and turn everything around 2 days after the election, or else you'll wind up in the partial reform equilibrium trap, which is like even worse than, and you know, that's not the historical pattern of economic and political development for most countries. Most places it happens gradually, and patronage and market-oriented economic relations coexist for a long time. Now, so that is my optimistic. My other project to go along with this has been to interview people at like meetings like this and ask them, okay, given this fact, have you thought about what it would look like to have this kind of hybrid system in Ukraine, partially reformed, partially not reformed, partially integrating with Western rules and institutions, but also partially knuckling under to the demands of Putin? And I'm sad to say that people don't seem to be thinking about what that kind of hybrid system could look like and whether it would be stable or how to make it stable.
Can I just chime in and actually give a pessimistic answer to Jack's optimism? I've done a little bit of research as well from my work on warlordism about violent patronage. And I would challenge Jack to name a country that practiced violent patronage that has emerged into a stable democracy without going through a major war or violent revolution. And the problem is, in both Russia and Ukraine, it is not just a matter of having what we might call corruption, of having patron-client relations at an economic level. It's that there are militias that are force-based supporters of individuals who act against the state. And the same thing has been true in Russia. And it is very unlikely that a force-based patronage system is going to easily reform itself eventually into a liberal democracy. So I hate to throw cold water on things.
Cold water on the ice blocks that are lying there already.
Well, if I may add some optimistic side to the story. Well, I think everybody agreed to that to a great degree, the cause of the problem, to a degree, is the current leadership in Russia. So the 50,000 Moscovites who went to the funeral of Nemtsov, this is something that people have to take note of. Then there are also signs that there is some discontent among the, let's say, not the inner circle of President Putin, but the second circle and the third circle. And there are some signs that some oligarchs who are still in the group of, you know, admirers, quote unquote, of Mr. Putin do have second thoughts. So, you know, with all respect to this system that exists in Russia, there are serious, you know, shortcomings, let's put it this way. And I would support this school of thought that something might happen within Russia, especially in view of the, you know, latest criminal act, tragedy, terrorist act that happened in the center of Moscow, you know, 200 meters from the Kremlin. This is also something that might at one moment make people think, at least those who are able to think. Thank you.
Please, yeah, please.
My example is England at the time of the Magna Carta. This is not my example. This is the example from Nobel Prize winner Douglas North and his co-author, famous political scientist Barry Weingast, in a book on the social origins of violence. And their argument is that the institutions of law and political representation that allowed not only social stability, but ultimately allowed a transition to a democratic liberal society and economy, had their origins in elite bargains between gangs of armed thugs who didn't want to spend all day, every day, killing each other, but rather wanted to set out some regularized rules for how they were going to divide the opportunities to exploit everybody else. And these rules, over time, became what we now call the rule of law, once the rest of the population was allowed to participate in those institutions.
You have to allow me to answer, Jack. The truth is that England never had a completely warlord-based system, because there were always a series of laws that governed the relationship between these lords and the king. And so, yes, it had some semblance of warlordism, but I made a mistake in the article that I published about, at this point, close to 10 years ago, where I argued that the European state-based system grew out of warlordism. It did not.
Get your money back. I'm no
And these people don't have a lot of empirical evidence behind what they're saying. It's a lot of formal models.
I would say a couple of points. I can't draw a clear path. But the low oil prices, I think, are a really important constraint. And if oil prices stay low, one could imagine a Russia that recognizes how tightly linked the future of any government is to the state of its economy. If you look at public approval ratings in Russia from 1991 to 2012, the correlation between approval ratings and the underlying economy is really very high. Since 2012, it's gone in a different direction as Putin has played the nationalist card. So if oil prices stay low, one could imagine a scenario where Putin says, well, I've got to, take care of the economy at home. One could also imagine a scenario where the economy comes so bad that he blames it all on scapegoats and we get a diversionary war scenario. Another important consideration is Europe. Europe's economies have to turn around, I think, if they're going to play any role in trying to pull Ukraine out of its current really bad equilibrium. Europe itself has to get its own act in order to make it be an appealing, more appealing destination for Europe and for Russia. I mean, one of the things that has helped President Putin on the domestic front tremendously has been the collapse of Europe after the financial crisis in 2008 and its great chaos. He points to this and says, you want democracy, you want market economy? Well, this is what it is. It's, 27% unemployment in Spain. Look at us. We've been growing. So I think if we think of kind of paths out of the current equilibrium, low oil prices is one thing that could allow for a more optimistic scenario, as well as Europe getting its act together. And, of course, a lot of this still lies in the Ukrainians in the Ukrainians' hands. So, good. Next question. Hey, you've already had a chance. How about over there in the corner?
Hi there. I had a question, perhaps particularly for Mr. Kuchinsky. Can you speak to? Can you judge Ukrainians' willingness to pay the near-term financial price for whatever long-term political or economic or financial benefit there may be from integrating with Europe? That is, per the IMF package, gas prices are doubling or something. And I even read that some pensions are being decreased by 15%. At some point, I'm thinking that the Ukrainians might decide the price is too high. Could you speak to that, please?
Well, this is a good question. Well, as a matter of fact, a little history. You know that former President Yanukovych was about to sign the association agreement with the European Union. And in fact, there was a decision by the Cabinet of Ministers in support of signing the association agreement. And then after the well-known events, after the well-known meetings, he abruptly changed his course. So during that time, after he changed his course and then he refused to signing the association agreement, his economic experts prepared, somewhat belatedly, the real picture of Ukraine becoming, well, closely associated with the European Union. And apparently there were a lot of difficulties that Ukraine will face. So without going into, you know, details and calculating, the feeling in the country, it's all happened, it just, this is the reality, that if there was a referendum now in Ukraine, whether Ukrainians, I mean, speaking today, literally, would like to be part of Europe and join the European Union, I would say that over 80% would favor it, would answer yes. The same stands true to an extent about the membership in NATO. You know, this experiment with non-bloc status of Ukraine with the former president, it did not stop the intervention of Ukraine. Ukraine declared a non-bloc status, and it was, you know, there was an intervention, the occupation of its territory. So from Ukrainian point of view, it's from an average Ukrainian, not to speak about oligarchs who are maybe included in this category, it's much more better to be associated with Europe than with Russia. Because maybe one of the reasons they, perhaps some of them, visited Europe and saw the differences that existed. But for most of them, they know what the life was during the old times. So even with a few exceptions, and the people from Eastern Ukraine who were brainwashed by the Russian propaganda, still a lot of people would, if they could speak openly, they would prefer to be associated with Europe, but not with Russia and its customs union.
One follow-up on that, and this relates to Gail's question as well, is Bulgaria and Romania in 1996 and 1997 had economic crises that were easily on the order of Ukraine's. They didn't have, you know, the occupation of 20% of the country, the seizure of Crimea, which complicates matters significantly. But these were both incredibly criminalized economies as well. And the notion that, you know, if 1996, we could look forward and say, you know, within a decade, they'd be members of the European Union, I think few people would have taken that bet. Now, if Bulgaria and Romania is your optimistic scenario, it's important to keep that in context. Peter and then Igor, and then I think we should take Peter's question, then we'll take Igor's question, and I think we'll have some closing remarks, because we could go on all night.
I want to build on Alex's point about the two scenarios. Alex, you suggested strongly the more likely outcome was this prolonged frozen conflict, which I read as de facto partition. If that's the scenario that we end up in, how good are the prospects would all of you give Ukraine for actually going down this economic reform path absent that piece of real estate and the resources in that real estate?
Well, there is a famous political analyst and expert, Professor Motyl, who has been famous for his theory even before the war started and part of Eastern Ukraine was occupied. His idea was that Ukraine can succeed without that part of the country for various reasons. And so maybe that will be the outcome. As a matter of fact, you know, it's also absolutely in the minds of every politician in Ukraine, whoever, an opposition or current leadership of the country, leave us alone, and then Ukraine will be able to succeed. Don't try to, you know, interfere. Don't try to, you know, break us. If that is achieved, the process will be much more easier. Thank you.
Yeah, just so it's really interesting. So actually, there's no single economic model in the frozen conflicts. They vary quite a bit. And if you think, look at sort of South Ossetia, right? That up to 2004, 90% of its economic activity was with Georgia, in fact, and now that's been flipped, right? Transnistria has had economic links, has been able to export and re-export via Moldova in an arrangement to the EU. In fact, we send aid programs to Transnistria, something that we never did, to sort of Abkhazia and so forth. Nagorno-Karabakh is very isolated, right? Its only economic option is Armenia and trading partner, and now by extension the EU. So there are different models there. What I see is troubling in terms of sort of its political consequences, and this is what I mean when I say sort of the freezing of the conflict, is, you know, this impulse to cut off pension systems, social welfare payments. And I absolutely agree with Tim. You know, all this, you know, there's a sense that, you know, Russia wants to have its cake and have everyone else pay for it too. And that being said, I think the damage that does in terms of reifying notions of normative political space, belonging, citizenship, and identity, to have these payments, you know, pulled and essentially have, you know, the economic space sort of geopoliticized, I think is quite negative. So, you know, I think that's why I'm not so much a fan of the modal plan as others might be, because I think, you know, there are kinds of creative arrangements. And since we're all being optimistic, the most optimistic scenario in these kinds of sort of, you know, frozen conflict lacunas is that they're used for arbitrage. And some people call it smuggling. Some people call them sort of navigating rule sets. I mean, so there are different models out there. There's not one single sort of frozen conflict, but I just think where we're headed is to this just kind of partitioning of interactions, which I think is damaging over the long run.
Yeah, we also might want to bear in mind there's been 6,000 war dead, a million displaced, and, you know, frozen conflict looks a little, you know, in some normative dimensions might look a little bit better than fighting. Yeah. We have one more question? Yeah, right here.
I think it's interesting that nobody so far mentioned the United States and what position the United States might have vis-a-vis the conflict. Mm-hmm. I think we're all sort of becoming, you know, there's different theories of psychoanalytic theories of Putin. One of them goes as he doesn't recognize the government as Ukraine as being autonomous. He doesn't really even recognize the Europeans as acting in any kind of, you know, autonomous way outside of the United States. And so whatever final settlement has to be made, if there's a final settlement, would have to be done between the United States and Putin. And is there thinking in D.C. that, I don't know, some of you might have insight as to what the end game might be, or do people in Washington recognize that that's sort of the view from the other side? Any thoughts?
Can I just argue that I'm not sure that it would be good for the United States to play a direct role in the negotiations? And the reason is that Putin has said repeatedly that he does not respect President Obama and that he does not think that President Obama is worth negotiating with. And I think the best evidence of that was probably the very nasty opinion piece that Putin wrote for the New York Times that was published on the 12th anniversary of September 11th. But I think that there have been other cases as well where Putin has explicitly told the media that he does not believe that Obama has sufficient control over his own country to be a good negotiating partner. So I would challenge the premise of your question. And I think we actually all have been talking about the United States in the history, so I don't think we ignored the topic at all.
I think in some sense President Obama shares the view that relations with Russia and the personal relationship with Putin is not all that great. I mean, one view from, you know, kind of a realist school of thought says, look, that this is just, this is not that important an issue for the United States, that, you know, we have lots of issues around the world, we have scarce resources, this is very close to Russia's backyard, and we should be careful about becoming involved, and that there's a slippery slope between rhetorical support, defensive weapons support, and, you know, does the U.S. want to get involved in that? So that's kind of one set of end game. Another end game is that there is this united front of the U.S. and Europe, which I think ultimately, you know, sits down with, you know, President Putin, perhaps with in possession of a Crimean land bridge, perhaps not, but then has a serious negotiation about what the rules of the game are going to be going forward on issues of national sovereignty, territorial integration, on economic relations between the country. Another scenario is that, you know, the status quo just continues for a long period, that there is this effort by Russia to keep Ukraine weak and unstable. The Europeans have a long time to take a long time in getting their economic house in order. There's a detached United States that's worried about the Middle East, about you know, economic development that turns more inward, and that the situation just festers for a long period of time. I can see that easily as an equilibrium as well. So from a range of, you know, very negative to mildly negative, I think those are three ways that, you know, we could see this conflict going forward. So you've all been very patient, and you've also been very lucky, because I think we've had the kind of discussion here that we really like to see at Harriman, where we have, you know, academics from a variety of perspectives bringing to bear, you know, years of experience, years of research that they have conducted to bear on what are really important public policy questions, and really smart questions from an engaged and intelligent audience. So we've all been very lucky, and I want to thank you all for coming, and I really want to thank our panelists for an engaging and lively and substantively important discussion. Thank you all.